Father Bienvenido Nebres used to be the longest-serving president of Ateneo de Manila University. He was installed to the position in 1993 and retired almost two decades later. Father Ben, as he is fondly called by the Ateneo community, he taught mathematics. In his early years, he established the Ateneo Center for Educational Development, or ACED, that provides education to poor children and conducts training to public school teachers. He is chairman of Sinergia Foundation, which works with mayors and local school boards to improve public education in about 200 municipalities, many of them in ARMM. Father Ben is People Asia People of the Year 2010 awardee. He is also a member of the Board of Trustees of the Knowledge Channel Foundation. Most recently, he was named National Scientist by President Benigno S. Aquino III.
As a priest, there is a sacramental ministry, usually masses in the college and Sundays, to say mass in Old Balara. Sometimes I join the scholastics in Payatas or other places. Educator, well, a lot of my life has been in education. As dean of the college, president of Xavier U, and then here also in Ateneo de Manila for 18 years, actually. And as a leader, well, I've been in leadership positions for a very long time. As I said, I was dean of the college in the 1970s. I was provincial of the Jesuits in the 1980s, during the period of transition from martial law till now. I think as a leader, my advocacy does follow very much the directions of the Jesuits and Ateneo, which we do want to promote excellence, but it has to be an excellence for people, for service. It has always been the two, and manifested itself in different ways. In the 1970s, the challenge was martial law. So on the one hand, how do you push excellence? So at that time, that was the time I developed the PhD programs in mathematics and physics and chemistry for the country, together with LaSalle and UP, as well as push excellence in the college. But at the same time, we really engaged martial law. I think we developed a lot of groups in Ateneo. So quite a lot of leaders today, like Secretary Buchabad, Sido Father Jet, and others, come from a period of engagement with martial law. In the 80s, the big challenge was the transition, the democratic transition. And I was provincial of the Jesuits, and we really tried to mobilize the whole Society of Jesus and the Church to play an important role in that transition, because it was quite challenging, because on the one hand, you really wanted to end martial law and to move on in terms of democratic reform, but we also wanted to do it in together our Christian faith and along democratic ways. And on that part, the battle was with the National Democratic Left. There's always a difficulty, you know, managing in the two. But we're grateful that we did follow a democratic path and move into a democratic government. However, the challenge of social reform remains. Unfortunately, while we have made progress on democracy, we have made very little progress on social reform. So that's where we're still at. Before, I used to think that maybe it has to do with simply the Western countries are better off. There is something that is deeper with us, and that really for me is a big challenge. Because if we don't come forward with that country, we don't really make progress and closing the gap between rich and poor. Just attaining Millennium Development Goal 1, which is cutting down extreme poverty and hunger. Well, 20 years from now, we'll really be the worst off country in this part of the world. Right now, my priority is that question of how do we really make progress in poverty. So part of it is working directly with groups and seeing how to scale them up. So one is public education, a very big advocacy of mine. We have an Ateneo Center for Educational Development. We work directly with municipalities or cities. We find that working with just individual schools is too small. Working with the whole country is too big. We cannot do that. So we have contracts with all of Quezon City, all the 143 schools of Quezon City to try to move them up. And Quezon City is very challenging because there's a lot of poverty in here. Many of the schools in Payatas are very big schools. And in fact, we find that with them, when you get down to education, it's not just a question of learning and books. We now have a feeding program for about 4,000 children, in 1,000 each in four schools. We had started with Jollibee Foundation they do it for one section per school, but that's too small. And so now we're doing it in four schools and we're learning how to do it in scale. And we're hoping that others will pick it up and begin to scale up. Because we find out that at least 20% of the children in the in the school system are really seriously malnourished. They fall asleep. In fact, of course, in the beginning, in the work with the public schools here, we were focused on the fact that they need classrooms. Toilets is terrible. They have 4 toilets for 4,000 children. So you can imagine this. So a lot of UTI, a lot of other problems that they have. In the beginning, it was that. But as we began to talk more with the teachers, they really zeroed in on this problem of children who come to school without having had anything to eat. We are only able to do the 1,000 each for 4 schools. It's quite a challenge to get the funding and the work for it, but we hope that in time we develop a model which we can pass on to other schools. It's really it's a big challenge. But you know, one of the things really is that how do we make the general population aware of how serious the problem? We signed the protocol 1990 for the Millennium Development Goals, MDG 1 and MDG 2. So Millennium Development Goal is to cut in half extreme poverty and hunger, and Millennium Development Goal 2 is universal primary education. And the first one in 1990, the Philippines was about 40% in terms of the poverty and hunger. We are supposed to cut it down to 20% by 2015. We're still at 33 or 34. But if you look at our neighbors, Indonesia was at 20% in 1990. They brought it down to 8% a few years ago. Thailand was around 40% then. They brought it down to about 18%. Vietnam was 58%. They've also brought it down to 18%. So of the major countries in our region, we're really the only one that has not made serious progress. And universal primary education, we are very far behind. Out of every 2.4 million children who enter grade 1, about 500,000 drop out already by grade 4, and about 800,000 drop out for grade 6. And the two top poverty goals that we signed, we are very far. For me, it's serious that we are far behind, but it's even more serious that we don't talk much about it. And for me, the worst part of it is that people come out with solutions in education that don't address these problems. They want to give computers, they want to do this. What does that do in terms of this much more serious problem? As we also do, of course, the usual training for teachers. We actually, when we set up this Ateneo Center for Educational Development 15 years ago, we did actually do the normal things. We do teacher training, we do development of materials, principals training. After 5 years, we said, has the whole school improved? We find out that if you want to help a school improve, the first thing is not input. The first thing is not teacher training or textbooks or anything. The first thing is to engage them, to get them to see where they are, and to get them committed to change. If you can do that, then your inputs more will really work slowly. If you don't, then your inputs is like going through a sieve, just goes right through. I think the challenge, can say, with working with schools is not to measure inputs, but to measure outcomes. That's what we try to do. We try to say that while inputs are nice, at the end of the day, what really happens? When you begin to do that, when you look at outcomes, have the children improved, have the scores improved, you begin to realize there are many other things that you need to attend to. And that's why it's so important that you engage the whole community. It's so important that you engage the parents, the teachers, and because many of these problems you cannot solve. You can help, but at the end of the day, they have to take responsibility for it. Like in the feeding programs, we get the mothers to come in teams to do the cooking because we cannot feed them forever. So we hope that at the very least, the mothers will learn more, well, they can actually provide a nutritious meal for 11 pesos. No? Well, first, I had some experience obviously in technology education. I work a lot in the mathematics and science education internationally and locally, and so we have also studied what the experience is. Very roughly, it goes something like this. The technologies, whether it's the internet or whether it's television or other radio, they're very, very good for information, for getting information. Certainly accessing information through the internet, through internet encyclopedias and so forth, are much faster than, and you can get a tremendous amount of information on the web. It's also very good in terms of there are certain subjects like geography or learning about other countries where the visual and other things are very important. As far as learning, say, mathematics or science, there are a few good software, not very many. In the case of mathematics, there is a Geometer Sketchpad, which is actually quite good for teaching geometry. The teachers can handle it well. In terms of science, sometimes some modeling is very good for visualization. However, for learning skills, there's nothing like simple steel, pencil, and paper. and other things. If you really want to learn basic skills, whether it's writing skills, how to write a good paragraph, or how to do a mathematics problem, there's still no substitute for. The experience also of using technology in the classroom, you can do it, but you really have to build a very strong support system for it. It's quite a mistake to, say, for example, give a few computers to a school and expect the teacher to use it in the classroom. If you want to do it that way, you really have to invest not just in the hardware and the software, you have to invest in a whole backroom support staff. Otherwise you'll find out that you actually waste a lot more time. The challenge really is to know when to use it appropriately. It can be wonderful. As I said, this geometry sketchpad is wonderful. And some of the visualization in physics or chemistry is quite wonderful. You have to know when to use it and when it works. We always have the temptation to try to substitute for the existing system, because we say the public school system is not doing well, so we should just have more private schools. There's no way the private system can make up. There's no way that the private school system could handle 20 million kids. The philosophy that we have taken is we work within the system and we try to get the system to work. So the philosophy we have taken is actually to work with the whole 143 schools in Quezon City and 30 schools in Parañaque and about 200 schools in Nueva Ecija. And to get the system, to help the principals and the teachers and the parents, the barangay captains, the mayors, to get involved and to take responsibility for their schools. It's a slower process, it's a more patient process, but in the end it's more sustainable. And what you provide is expertise, what you provide is connections with donors for classrooms and other things. But at the end of the day, clear that what you really try to do is to build capability among them so that they can do things themselves. So maybe the philosophy that we have taken in a lot of the work is that when you enter into situations like public education or public health, the challenge that faces us is how to go in and help and make the system work, not to try to create another system, because that's not scalable. You'll be able to do it for a small group. If you want it to scale up, you have to get in there, show how it can work in certain systems. And as I said, I tell our younger Jesuits, you have to help make institutions work. Don't try to substitute for the institutions, because you cannot. The situation actually that we have, sometimes people in the private sector complain that we have bad teachers and so forth. I suppose we have some bad teachers. Our Ateneo Center for Educational Development, who work very closely with the situation of teachers, say, in the public schools in Metro Manila, in Quezon City and others, say that for the most part, they're quite good. Many of them, but they're overburdened, they're overwhelmed. Like talking to Sylvia Pagsanghan, who works with the high schools, she says she goes to Commonwealth High School. She's quite impressed with the quality of the teachers. But she says, you put yourself in their place, they have 80 students in a class, and they're trying to talk at the top of their voice for 5 hours a day. That's hard. I don't think that I disagree when people say that the biggest problem are the teachers. If you actually get down there, they're quite heroic. But you have to do something about their working conditions. You go into these schools and you have 70, 80 kids per class. Pagkakatabilang kayo, so it's quite noisy. So the energy that you have to expend to do that, they don't really have libraries for reference materials. I think what you really need to do is to work harder to provide the resources so they have working conditions that's more suitable for them and more suitable for the students. The programs that you have are wonderful for the children, because a lot of it opens their eyes to information, to a reality that they would never see. And especially at those ages, engaging the imagination is fantastic. No? As far as skills development is concerned, I would address it more to the teachers. I don't think you could really, through something like Knowledge Channel, because at the end of the day, if you want to develop skills, a program in there has still to be carried out by the teacher. So I would focus a lot, when it comes to skills, I would focus it much more on the teachers. And the teachers can use it if they wish. But the programs that Knowledge Channel has in terms of knowledge about history, about the country, or also in terms of deepening concepts that they've already learned in class, that's quite important. I think the challenge really is how to find a way to get the teachers together with the programs in Knowledge Channel to work closely together. It's very important to reach the children, but teachers need something like Knowledge Channel, because napakalimited talaga yung resources nila. Teaching certain subjects like science or Raling Panlipunan, they really need resources, especially about the country. They can get a lot of things about the United States on the internet, but there's not very much about the Philippines. Well, actually parents and the youth. We did a study in Ateneo many years ago. First we did a study of the Ateneo High School about best practices. We identified high school students who were good academically or good in sports, or basta magaling in some area. And we tried to talk to their parents and found out what are the values and things that they did. We were very happy with that. What we found there is that actually have families, the children, some of them very, very poor, but the children do extremely well. We studied what they did, and you find out that the very first thing they emphasize really is, they say discipline. Kailangang disiplinado sila. So there are several values they put in them. And the parents really focus on making sure that they create an environment that the children can learn in. So some of them are very poor, they just have one room. So ang ginagawa nila is that after they eat in the evening, they clean out everything and they leave the children. Siguro ilang lunch lang sila. They leave the children there to work by themselves. And sabi nila, if we want to watch TV, we turn off the sound so that they can study. It's both creating the environment and showing the children that they really want them to study. In fact, we were very touched by one parent who said, when we asked them, don't your children rebel when you discipline them? And they said, hindi ho, kasi disiplinado rin kami. Like, you know, on the days that they have to take examination, sometimes we do not eat so that they can eat more food. So the children see that. So what we find is that while we want to give advice for the youth, maybe more fundamental is to engage the parents. Because no matter what you and I say to the youth, at the end of the day, the parents are the most influential.